A mother walked into her son's bedroom one Sunday morning and told him to get up and get ready for church. He said, "Mama, I don't want to go to church today." She said, "Don't you give me that, son. You get up and you get ready because you're going to church." That's the way it was around our house. We didn't get to decide. We had a drug problem. We got drugged to church. He said, "Mama, church is boring. And you know, I don't like those people. And you know, they don't like me down there at that church." And she said, "Well, you're going to go anyway, so just get up and get ready." He said, "Mama, can you give me just one single reason? I bet you can't give me one single reason why I should go." She said, "Well, I'll give you three. First of all, it's the right thing to do. Second, it's good for you. And third, you're the pastor, so get up and get ready. You're going to church." And sometimes one of the problems that we have is that we get a case of the "I don't want to." And believe it or not, one of the biggest reasons people just don't believe in Jesus, don't do the very most necessary thing to be saved, that people don't come to faith in Jesus Christ, is simply the reason the Bible tells us is because they don't want to. They don't put their trust in Jesus because they don't want to. John chapter 3 and verse 18, which we studied just a few weeks back in this study, Jesus said, "He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth on him believeth not is condemned already, because he's not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." And so much for that universal salvation, that everybody's just saved. No, you need to come to faith in Jesus Christ. "He that believeth not is condemned already, because he's not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." And Jesus went on to say in verse 19, "This is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil." The biggest reason that people don't believe in Jesus is because they're too much in love with their own sin, and they're perfectly happy with their lives just the way they are. They don't believe in Jesus not because they can't believe, they just don't want to believe. And just like Jesus said, men are under condemnation because of that choice. They're going to be judged by God. They're going to spend eternity in hell because they've chosen their sin over Jesus Christ. The wonderful thing that we're going to see in our message this morning is that even though people are living in unbelief, and even though people have chosen, you know, and they're still living in unbelief, God, even so, in His wonderful mercy, reaches out and He'll try to show them in mighty ways, sometimes through miracles, sometimes through His perfect provision at the perfect time, sometimes even through tragedy. Yet regardless of the way God does it, He reaches into our lives and He lets us know that He's there. And the scripture we're looking at this morning shows us exactly that in the life of one particular man. We're going to see some people who are having a problem with unbelief. But we're also going to see the length to which Jesus will go to help people believe. And you see, sometimes the Lord reaches down into people's lives and shakes the ground a little bit to wake us up, to let us understand that He's here. And thank God that He does that. We're going to see that today. So if you want to follow along, we have a study guide on the back of the bulletin this morning. Our first point this morning, as we begin in verse number 43, we see an unusual reception. That's point number one this morning. Beginning in verse number 3, the Bible says, after 2 days, remember, Jesus has been in Samaria, and He's preached, He's shared the gospel with that woman there at Jacob's well in Sychar, and she's gone out, she's told the other men, and all the other people have come to Jesus, and they've been talking to Him, and they said, "We believe first because of her word. Now we believe because of your word." They've met Jesus, and they believe. And so it says, after 2 days, He departed from thence. He left Samaria, and He went into Galilee, and Galilee's where Jesus grew up, and it's where He lived His life. And it says, for Jesus Himself testified that a prophet hath no honor in his own country. Now, if you remember, like I said, last Sunday, we talked about the fact Jesus and His disciples, they spent 2 days there in Samaria preaching the gospel to the Samaritan people, and many of them came to put their trust in him. But now he's leaving Samaria. He's returning to Galilee where he grew up. And as they're making their way back towards his hometown, Jesus begins to talk to his disciples. He begins to talk to them and kind of prepare their hearts. And he's telling them about something that each one of them is, you know, most likely going to face as they go through their ministry. It's a very sad reality, but Jesus, as Jesus said there in verse 44, he said, "A prophet hath no honor in his own country." In other words, what Jesus is saying, he's saying, don't be surprised if the people in your own hometown are not very excited about what you're doing. They're not too impressed with your life. Don't let it get you down if the people who watched you grow up don't have much faith in you. Let me try to give you a little example of what I'm talking about, what Jesus is saying here. There was this guy that I went to school with. Me and Bridget both went to high school with him. And, of course, you guys, you that are members here, you know what road me and Bridget took, which, you know, we got married to each other, and it's led us eventually to right here at Castleberry, and we thank God for every bit of that. But one day we were in the Christian bookstore, and we were looking at some music, and Bridget brings me this CD and showed me this picture on it. And it turns out that there's this guy that we went to high school with. I sat just a couple chairs down from him in the choir. I could look over and see him there. And he had become the lead singer of a very popular group called Mercy Me. And his name is Bart. And for about 10 years, every time that you went to a funeral, you probably remember that every time you went to a funeral, they were playing the song, "I Can Only Imagine." And that is the guy that sat down right over here by me, Bart, okay? And if you'd have known this guy in high school, you'd have thought maybe he acted more like Bart Simpson than Bart Millard. But, and if you'd have asked me years ago if I thought that guy would have ever accomplished something like that, I would have said, no, dude can't sing. You know, I'd have said something like that. And Bridget's standing there showing me that picture, and the only thing I could say was, man, look how fat he got, you know? And she was looking at me like, pot, kettle, you know? You're the kettle, is what she's saying to me. But anyway, then Bridget says, yeah, man, I should have married him. But anyway, that's the kind of thing that Jesus is talking to his disciples about here. Nobody really thinks that anything great could be happening in the life of the people that they watched growing up. They're not too excited about the potential of the kid that lives around the corner. We can think about the prophets of the Old Testament who preached God's message to the people they lived among. Noah preached of God's coming judgment for over 120 years, and nobody listened to him except for his family. Joseph told his brothers about his dreams, and they threw him in a pit, and they sold him into slavery. Jeremiah preached God's word in Jerusalem and told them that God was going to send Babylon to judge them, and nobody believed him, and they threw him in a dungeon. And Babylon still came, regardless of whether or not anybody believed him or not. And all the kinds of stories like that can be found in the Old Testament. And as Jesus went about doing his ministry, he came across a lot of people who had that kind of mindset towards him. And he'd come into a city and he's preaching, and he would say, who does this guy think he is? Isn't he just the son of a carpenter? We remember him when he was just a little kid. We remember his brothers and his sisters. Why does he think he's so special to say the things he is? And Jesus is talking about that fact that a prophet has no honor in his own country. People aren't that impressed with the people they grew up with. And so Jesus and his disciples, they're returning to Galilee, there where they grew up, and he's starting to tell them, he's trying to prepare them for this kind of truth, and he's saying to them, that's the way it is out there in the world. Don't expect to get a lot of honors from the people who you know. But then, here's where the story got kind of interesting. Verse number 45 goes on and it says, then when he was coming to Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things that he did at Jerusalem at the feast, for they also went unto the feast. Okay, so understand What's happening here, Jesus is telling the disciples how it's hard to get respect and honor from the people in your own hometown that know you. And Jesus is telling them how tough that is. But when they actually got there to his hometown where he grew up, he starts coming in the city. There's a big welcome party there for him. And they're receiving them with joy. They're excited about the fact that Jesus and his disciples. And Jesus has warned us about that kind of thing, what might normally happen. We can understand that what Jesus is saying is true, that people might not get all that excited about a prophet in his own country. But you see, Jesus, the thing about Jesus is that he overruled all of that, what normally might happen. Jesus overruled the ordinary because he was extraordinary. He's such a magnificent person that his love overpowered what people might normally be limited by. And not only were the words which he spoke wonderful and powerful and compelling, but they were loving and they were compassionate, and his healing miracles were irresistible. And so the people come out to meet him. They came out to meet him. And so as he came home to that place where he grew up, they're excited. They're lining up there just to see him. Okay, now that all sounds good. It's kind of unusual for somebody to come back to their own town and be received like that. But that's what happens with Jesus. And all these people are gathered around. But even though things, and that looks really good, you know, when people are excited to see Jesus. But even though things look really good like this on the surface, there's a problem. There's an underlying problem. And it's unbelief in the heart of the people. And Jesus is about to talk about it. And that is to say, these people are fascinated with Jesus, and they're fascinated with his power, and they're fascinated with his miracles, but they've not come to the point where they're ready to believe in him as their Savior. They want Jesus to pour out some kind of blessing on them right now. I hope you're listening. They want Jesus to fix something in their lives right now, but they're not even thinking about the most important thing in their lives right now. And so the second point in our outline this morning is an unexpected rebuke. Now look at verse 46 with me. It says, "So Jesus came again into Cana of Galilee, where he made the water into wine." You remember that miracle that we looked at back in John 2. "And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death." And so in the midst of this crowd that's come to see Jesus in his own hometown, all these people are here to see Jesus, and they're excited about him. In the midst of all that, we see one man, a desperate dad. And his son is so severely sick that he's almost at the point of death. There's no feeling more miserable than the fear of losing one of your children. I can remember when my daughter spent 9 days in the hospital, I can remember the doctor saying her blood is septic and she needs an operation, but we can't operate on her because her blood is poisoned right now, because her kidneys have stopped working. And the only thing we could do is just pray. And I remember that thought of that first child that my wife and I brought into the world. She mostly brought it into the world, but I held her hand while she did. I encouraged her. As I look at this scripture this morning, I can't even begin to imagine the fear and the sorrow in this father's heart. He would do anything for his son's life, to save his son's life. He's not a poor man. He's a nobleman, the Bible says, and so he has some money. He's not poor. He can afford to pay a doctor, but apparently no doctor has been able to help his child, and the child's just getting sick, and he's at the point of death. And this father's feeling trapped in a dark, impossible situation. But just when he's feeling the darkness close in, listen, just when he's about ready to give up, he heard about this man, Jesus. People are saying that he might be the Messiah. He could be the Messiah. But you know, there's something that feels a little bit more important in this man's life right now. to him right now, it feels just a little more important that his son is dying. People are saying that he can heal people of sickness and disease. And so this desperate dad, determined to do something for his son, he makes the trip 20 miles out to where Jesus was. And when he got there, the Bible says he besought Jesus that he would come down and heal his son. And that word besought means that he begged Jesus, and to the point of interrogating, he was begging Jesus, arguing with Jesus about why won't you come down and heal my son. It was a desperate plea from a desperate dad. He's willing to do anything to save his son, holding on to any hope that Jesus might heal his son. But notice what happens in verse 48. Then Jesus said unto him, except ye see signs and wonders, you will not believe. And that doesn't sound like a very nice thing to say to a person who's trying to get help for his dying son. Listen, it doesn't seem very compassionate, does it? It almost seems like Jesus is ignoring a huge problem that was right there in front of his face. It almost seems like Jesus doesn't care about this man or about his son. But I know that's not the case. And I want you to think about this with me for just a moment. When you just kind of back up a little bit and look at the story from the broader view of what's going on, not just with his father and his son, but what's going on spiritually. And ask the question here, is the biggest issue that Jesus is not rushing to heal this father's sick son? Or is the much bigger, much more massive issue that an entire crowd of people are ignoring their own sin and ignoring their own need to be saved by putting their faith in Jesus Christ? What's the greater need? The physical healing of the body or the spiritual salvation of the soul? To be saved is more important. What's worse, that one person is physically dying or that an entire crowd of people are lost and headed for hell and don't even seem to care about it? That's a bigger problem. Because I want to tell you, physical healing is only temporary, but hell, it's eternal. And so Jesus is looking into the hearts of these people and he's seeing the greater need and he's trying to get them to see it too. And it reminds me of that story there in Mark chapter 2 when the four friends bring that friend of theirs to that house in Capernaum. And, you know, they bring him and they tear up the roof and they lower him down to where Jesus is because they want Jesus to heal this man. And Jesus looks at the guy and you would think maybe Jesus would say, okay, you're healed, rise up, take up your bed and walk. But Jesus doesn't say that. Jesus says, your sins are forgiven you. And Jesus looked in his heart and said, you need to be saved. And guys, what I'm saying to you this morning is that we're here in this room this morning, and many of us, we have a prayer list a mile long here in this church. The one you saw on the bulletin is just a small sample of some of the really, really pressing ones. And we have a prayer list that we keep updated all the time, and we pray over these needs. And we've got many people here in this room this morning, and I can guarantee you that there are many of you who are praying to God about specific things in your life, and you feel like these are big issues that you need God to help you with, and maybe you feel like they're the most important things going on in your life. But I want to tell you this morning, if you've not been saved, your salvation is more important than anything else that could be going on in your life. Nothing is as important. Jesus said, if your hand offends you, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you, for it's better for you to enter into life maimed, to go through your life without a hand, than to enter into hellfire. If something keeps you from Jesus, it would be better for you to totally cut it off and get rid of it. It's more important that you be saved more than anything. And so Jesus is saying to the people, and he's not just talking to this man. There's a whole crowd of people that are doing the same thing. All they care about is, I've got something going on in my life that I want you to help me with right now. And Jesus is trying to tell them there's something bigger going on here. And you won't seem to believe unless you see miracles. He's trying to tell them there's something bigger than miracles here. Something bigger than physical healing here. Something bigger than God breaking into your life and fixing this little thing or that thing. God wants to save your soul. And so the third point in our outline this morning, there's an unrepentant reply. An unrepentant reply. This guy's come to Jesus and he's telling him, you need to heal my son. I need you to come with me and heal my son. Jesus said, you got a bigger problem right now. You need to get focused on the big problem. And this guy says in verse 49, he doesn't listen to Jesus' argument. He just simply says what's really bothering him. And if we have to be honest, in our hearts, we're all just like this guy here. We've all got little things in our life that are distracting us. We've all got big things in our life that are distracting us. This guy's son was sick. And I know I need to get my soul right with Jesus, but my son is dying. And so he says, the nobleman saith unto him, verse 49, the nobleman saith unto him, sir, come down ere my child die. Please come down. Even though it seemed like Jesus is answering him kind of in a rough way, he didn't give up. And you know, some people are proud. You talk to them the way Jesus did here, and they say, well, I'm done. I don't have to listen to this. But this man's pride has left long ago. When you see your child laying in a bed, dying, you'll forget about all your ego and your pride. It'll just go away. And he just continues to beg Jesus to help his son. And maybe you're here this morning and you're just hoping for something from God this morning. Maybe you're praying for something from God. Maybe you're desperate. Maybe you hear us talking about salvation and you hear us talking about trusting Jesus and you just don't understand it yet because maybe you're just distracted. You've got a lot of other things going on in your life. I want to tell you this morning, don't give up asking. Don't give up praying. Hold on to the feet of Jesus and keep on asking Him because He's merciful and He's loving and He's forgiving and He'll reach down into your life and He's compassionate and He will show you His presence. But listen, whatever struggle you're going through, no matter how big the problem is that you're trying to get Jesus to fix, there's something much bigger that He wants to fix. He wants to save your soul. So number four, we have an undeserved reward. In verse number 50, Jesus saith unto him, go thy way, thy son liveth. Go thy way, thy son liveth. And this guy did not yet trust Jesus as his Savior. He didn't yet understand all that. At this point, he's just crying out for Jesus for a miracle in the midst of a desperate situation. He's saying, Jesus, I love my son. If there's any hope for me or my son, my family, you're it because you're all I've got. I know you want me to think more about more than your miracles. I know you want me to think about what's wrong between me and you right now, but right now, I'm having a hard time with that. And so Jesus looked at him, knowing that what he really needed was to trust him as Savior more than his son needed to be healed, knowing that his biggest need was to be forgiven more than his son needed to be healed. But at the same time, he looked at him through those eyes of compassion, and he said, I'll help you. I'll show you a glimpse of my power if it'll help you believe that I love you and I want to save you. Go thy way, thy son liveth. Don't ever give up asking him. But remember, as you do, there's a greater need than this little problem you want fixed in your life. Fifth, this morning, we have an undeniable revelation. In verse number 50, the Bible continues, the man believed the word Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. Jesus said, go thy way, thy son lives. He believed what Jesus had said. And remember, he wanted Jesus to come with him to his house. He said, sir, come down ere my child die. And Jesus asked him, go on, go thy way, thy son lives. And he asked Jesus, but Jesus didn't go. He said, just go. He didn't have to touch that boy. He didn't have to be in the same room with that boy from 20 miles away. All he had to do was speak the word, think the thought, and that boy was healed. Jesus worked a long-distance miracle. Talk about reach out to touch someone. The little kids won't understand that. And that would be a pretty big claim for a lot of people to make. Go thy way, thy son lives. It would be a big claim coming from anybody else. But this is Jesus. And he has the right to claim it because he did it. He healed him in that moment. And the man believed him. He had to believe him. He was his only hope. Verse 51 says, as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, thy son liveth. Remember what Jesus said? Thy son liveth. Go thy way, thy son liveth. And now his servants have come out to meet him on the way back, and they say to him, thy son liveth. Just like Jesus said. Then inquired he of them the hour when he began to amend, and they said unto him, yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him. Exactly when Jesus said it, that boy was healed. He was lying in a bed. Nobody could help him. But the very moment, the very second Jesus said, go thy way, thy son liveth, that boy hopped out of that bed, got some cold pizza out of the refrigerator, started eating. Good as new. No mistaking it now. Jesus has done this for this desperate father, for his son, for his family. What no other person could have ever done, what the doctors couldn't do, and his power to do so was not limited by time, not limited by distance. The only conclusion is that Jesus must be the Savior that he claims to be. So as Jesus helps him, he's talking to him. You won't believe unless you see miracles, and what you need is to believe. You need your sins forgiven. You need to be made right. So as Jesus worked that miracle, the man believed what Jesus could do, and he must be the Savior he's claiming to be. And so that brings us to our sixth and final point this morning, an unleashed revival. Verse number 53. So the father knew it was at the same hour in which Jesus said to him, thy son liveth, and himself believed, and his whole house. Oh, earlier he believed the word of Jesus when he believed that Jesus was going to heal his son. When he said, go thy way, thy son liveth, he believed that. But now, overwhelmed by the power and overwhelmed by the compassion and the love that Jesus has shown him, he believes in the person of Jesus. And he says, I don't understand everything about it, but I know he did for me and my family what nobody else could ever do, and so I trust him. And the whole family witnessed that child being healed and their father. Don't worry about that noise. They're just beating some kids out there. We do that from time to time. Their father came home and told them the whole story. And they believed in Jesus too. You see, sometimes Jesus, even though we're stubborn and even though we're preoccupied with what we think we need, when he knows we need something more, sometimes Jesus, even when he knows that we're totally distracted, sometimes he'll reach into our lives and shake that very ground under our feet so that we'll know he's there. He did that for this guy. Now, I know there's some of you in this room this morning, and you felt that same awesome, compassionate presence of Jesus in your life. He's been your help when you needed Him desperately. Or maybe you're actually going through some things right now, and you desperately need Him to do something for you right now. And I would say to you, don't give up. Keep on asking, because He's powerful. He can do it. And He's compassionate. He's kind. He's compassionate to what we're going through. So keep on asking Him. Keep asking Him with all your heart. And if I know Jesus like I believe I know Him from His Word, I believe that if you keep on, you may just reach down into your situation. And He might do something for you that's just out of the ordinary, to show His presence. But at the same time, while you're asking for every little other thing in your life, remember there's something more important that you need. And it's not just to have everything in your life fixed. That's not what Jesus went to the cross to do. He didn't go to the cross and suffer and die so we could have health and wealth and prosperity and your best life now. Jesus didn't come and suffer and die on the cross to make our lives rosy and rainbows and unicorns. Jesus came and died on a cross. And boy, He gives us great blessings in this life. And He heals and He does wonderful things. But He came and suffered and died on the cross to help and to deliver us and to save us from our biggest problem, to help us with our biggest need. He came and suffered to pay the price of our sin. He was beaten with a whip. The stripes that were on His back were for the sins that you and I have committed. The Bible says that the chastisement that brought us peace, the punishment that brought us peace, was upon Him. And by His stripes, we're healed. So the bigger problem. Pray to Him about all the things. Yes, pray to Him and pray to Him about the things your friends need. But more, no, realize more than anything, you need to be saved. At the cross, I surrender.